happy afternoon. Happy Sunday afternoon. Even Elijah's taller than me. Everyone's taller than me. I've been doing this all day, lowering stands, because everyone that goes before me is so much taller than me. But good afternoon. I'm so excited to just continue on this series and dive together into this, continue on this journey of trying to figure out what it means to love the church, what that looks like. And one of the greatest joys in my life is being married to my husband, right? Oh, I know. Right, to be his wife, to be cared by him, to be loved by him in a way different than the way that he cares for and loves others. Right? And don't worry, Pastor Fabi. Oh my gosh, sorry. I bit something. It's okay. Don't worry. Of course, Pastor Fabi loves you guys so much and cares for you guys very deeply and very much. But his love for me is unique to me. This isn't me being arrogant or being delulu about someone's love for me. But rather, he loves me in a way that is only meant for me, right? His wife. And this is why, even though there's ups and downs, right? And even through them, and while you don't have to be married, you know, Pastor Fabi said this last week, I think. Sorry, I don't know why I have this one more thing stuck in my mouth. He said this last week, and we agree, like, you don't have to be married. But if I could, I would tell you guys, marriage, I would give marriage a 10 out of 10. It's great. It's lovely being married, right? This love that we have in marriage that I receive from my husband cannot be substituted or found elsewhere in human relationships, right? And today I bring this up because today we're going to continue on this journey together of loving the church, diving into, and as we do that, we're going to dive into what the church is, right? What the church is that and why we're called to love it. And today we are going to look at the picture that the church is the bride of Christ, right? And as we unpack and explore this picture of the church together, I pray that God will speak into our hearts and minds, and he'll fill us with an even greater understanding of his love for us, and consequently fill our hearts with greater love for the church. Amen? Amen? Guys, I see you. I see you. All right, so we're going to go into our passage. There are a few passages in the Bible in which the church is called the bride of Christ, in which authors use this imagery to show us who we are, right? And I think our passage today that comes out of Revelation paints us the most beautiful picture, this beautiful wedding. So in the midst of this revelation that John is receiving about the time that is to come, right? There lies this wonderful little gem, this wonderful little imagery that I just love very much. So let's read this together. It comes from Revelation chapter 19, verses 7 to 9. It's three verses, so if you guys can, I'll start us off. You guys read the second verse, and let's read the third verse together, all right? Let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory, for the wedding of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. Yeah. Fine linen stands for the righteous acts of God's holy people. Let's read verse 9 together. Ready, go. Then the angel said to me, write this, who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb. And he added, these are the true words of God. This is God's word. Amen. Pray with me. God, today we thank you so much as we continue in this journey in LAOCEM to figure out of just searching and seeking and trying to figure out how you want us to love the church, how we are to love the church. God, we dive into this imagery where you have called us your bride. And so, Lord, as we look into this, as we dive into this, God, won't you open up our hearts at this time? Won't you fill us with an even greater understanding and a greater love for you and for your people and for the church? So we give this time to you. We surrender to you at this time. We love you and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If you've ever been to a wedding, weddings are full of joy. Right? Weddings are full of joy. My husband and I had three weddings. I used to say this like jokingly, but I think about this often, like more seriously, where like, I must love my husband a lot. And of course, he must love me lots too. And we must have been so sure of our commitment to each other that all three times we said, I do. in case you are wondering. All three times we said, I do. The first one, we had a legal court ceremony where we stood before a judge and then our brother and sister-in-law right before COVID hit the States. And then we had this, like, the second, we had this, like, surprise wedding thrown for us by our pastor staff. There's, like, pictures on my Instagram, but I'm wearing black because I didn't know that I was going to have a wedding that day, right? It was a surprise wedding. It was really lovely, but still a surprise. And then the third wedding was our, like, big ceremony, but it was still during the pandemic, so we were limited to 75 guests. It was lovely. It was really beautiful. And even though that they, all three of them were, pretty much all three of them were during the pandemic and so different from the kind of weddings I had grown up envisioning and, you know, putting on my Pinterest board, right? Each wedding was full of so much joy and love, right? And in our passage today, we see that a great multitude, right? Right before this verse, the first verse that we read, we hear that the people who are saying this is a great multitude that sounded like the roar of rushing waters and thunder. And they are the ones that shouted, "The wedding of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready." And in case you weren't sure, Jesus is the Lamb, right? The wedding of the Lamb, Jesus is the Lamb, and his bride that they're talking about is the church. And so we're going to run with this imagery of the church being the bride of Christ, and we're going to explore two observations that we can make from this imagery, from this picture and of the wedding and of the marriage between Christ and the church. And this is going to help us understand and give us even more reason of why we should love the church. Okay. So our first observation... Our observation one is this. The bride is beautiful. Can you guys say that with me? Ready? Go. The bride is beautiful, right? Most of us are not married, okay? But if you have ever been married or if you've been part of a wedding, one of the biggest stresses of preparing for a wedding is a photographer, is photography. Because all that's left is pictures and videos, right? And so you want to get a good photographer who understands you, who knows you, and can capture the vibe that you are going for, that can capture the love and essence of your marriage in a picture, right? So we were blessed to have a really good friend of my husband be our photographer, someone we could trust. We didn't have to feel awkward around, and he's very talented. He's an artist. He had, like, all these, like, visions, even bigger than my visions. I felt so basic when he was like, what are your visions? I was like, oh, yeah, this. And he was like, okay, cool, cool. But what about this? And I was like, yes, that. I don't know how I'm going to do that, but that, right? And if you haven't been around weddings, like, one of the really important pictures, like a must do, and if you guys are ever going to get married in the future, something to think about, a really important picture is a first look photo or a video. Right? Because this first look photo is the first time during that day that the bride and groom is going to have seen each other in wedding attire. It's like the first moment when things become real, because up until then, everything's stressful. Like, oh, like, are the guests here? There's a lot of stress. But then that moment is like, even though there's other people around and the photographer, it's almost very intimate, because it's the first time you lay your eyes on the person that you are going to be spending the rest of your life with. And then it, like, hits you. Right? And the reason that these photos and videos are so memorable is that in that moment, the groom thinks that their bride is the most beautiful person in the world in that moment. I said, there's, like, entire reels on, like, TikTok and Instagram devoted to just, like, clips of the first time that the grooms see their brides, right? And so I thought I'd show you mine. So here's mine. I forgot to tell Pastor Fabio I was going to do this. Yeah, I have it. The video clip. Oh, it's hard to see his face, but it's there. Sorry, you have to see that. Yeah, so that was the whole clip, right? And yes, right? Then, yeah, like, I look all right. Yeah. So no, if you guys ever saw my wedding photos, it gets better progressively. Like my face progressively gets better throughout the day. I was so swollen in the morning. And here's the thing, in order to even look like even to that degree, do you know how much makeup I am wearing and how much I cut my hair the next day? Because like there was so much gel and wax built up in my hair. I'm just wearing so much makeup to hide my blotchy skin and like I have so much contour to like cover the swelling on my face. Because the night before we actually only got like 1 hour of sleep and I had like cried all night, right? So behind all that makeup, behind that, under that hair wax, there's wrinkles, there's uneven skin tones, there's flaws, faults, and imperfections, right? That's the same for the church. It's the same with God's people, us as Christ's bride, the church. We have imperfections. We are flawed, right? Someone told me recently that the church is like a hospital. Right, the broken, the weak, the sick, we are the ones, not they, who are coming, who seek a hospital, right? And to seek the great healer, to seek the great doctor. The doctor isn't there for healthy people. And that's who's gathered in the church, sinners who are in need of a savior. The church is filled with imperfect people with many flaws, even no matter how hard we try to hide it, right? This is the beauty of the church. This is the grace that we see only in church, is that you don't have to be perfect in order to come. You don't have to meet certain standards to be accepted into this club, right? Like a country club. It's not like that. You don't have to be perfect. You just have to come, right? We come from all different walks, and still God calls us and unites us into one, to his one bride, to one church, to be his bride. And just like the groom who isn't looking, like Fabi is not looking for my imperfections. Like his first thought isn't like, okay, that's a lot of makeup. Like what's under there? You know, like where are the wrinkles? Where are the imperfections? But just like that, Jesus, as he looks at us, his bride, he sees us and he says, wow, you're beautiful. He sees the bride as beautiful, not looking at the imperfections, not looking at the flaws. And church, this is who we are. The church is Christ's beautiful bride. And this leads us to our second observation. The bride is loved. Can you say that with me? Go. The bride is loved. It seems like something that doesn't have to be stated because it's such an obvious thing when it comes to marriage. But the bride is loved. Okay. And if you don't know, if you've ever thought about marriage, I don't know if you guys know this, so I don't want to like spoil it, but sometimes in marriage, the couple fights. I know, shocker, right? It's supposed to be perfect, beautiful, like, I don't know, whatever, every day, right? But we fight, right? And for those looking ahead to marriage, be excited. You get to have arguments for the tiniest little details in your life, like the way you squeeze the toothpaste or different cleaning styles. It's great, right? And it's not necessarily a bad thing to have these fights, depending on the way that you fight. But sometimes it's actually having those arguments, fighting, is a necessary step in the process of two people becoming one. A few months ago, my husband and I had this like big fight. And while I cannot remember all the details, it was one of our core fights. You know, the ones that are, that mostly come from our inner self, like inner insecurities, just the core of our being. The one it's most sensitive, and these ones expose your flaws a lot. And one of my core topics, one of my like core issues for when we fight is not feeling loved. I don't know if you guys, you know, have that, but mine is not feeling loved. And I know that I am, but sometimes I need that extra affirmation. And my husband's is feeling unheard, right? And so these fights are tough because when you have these core fights, both parties are often hurt. And because of their hurt, they often miss each other in what they're trying to get across. So the hurt kind of grows. Frustration and tension had built because we kept doing that. We kept missing each other. And I said to my husband, and I do not recommend this, but I turned to my husband and I said, do you really think you're being the husband God calls you to be? And I was like, what does it say in Ephesians chapter 5, don't fight like this, guys. It's not great. I do not recommend. 0 out of 10, right? And so it was so bad. We went into this whole argument. I was like, doesn't isn't the husband supposed to love the wife like the church? Like, he loves the church. And then it was like a whole back and forth, right? And we just went through this passage not too long ago, didn't we? A few weeks ago, right? My husband, this very pulpit, preached a message on Ephesians 5. Wow, right? It's online. Go check it out if you weren't there, right? And so I'm not going to go over it completely, but I do want us to kind of look at it again. Because in this passage, Paul also draws the picture of not just yes, marriage, but it's also the picture of the church being the bride of Christ, right? It draws on that imagery. Let's go to chapter 5, verses 25 to 30. I'm going to just read this for us, so please follow along as I read this out. Husbands, love your wives. This is where I'm starting. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any blemish, but holy and blameless. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and care for their body just as Christ does the church, for we are members of his body. And this, and I just want to point this out before we get delusioned. I didn't start here to cut off what Paul was saying to the wives. What he says to the wives is very important. But today our focus is not marriage, but Christ and the church. And this is where I want to show you how Christ loves the church, right? This picture that was drawn in this passage right now, it's an intense picture of love, isn't it? Christ gave himself up for the church. Christ gave up his life for the bride, for the church, in order to make her holy and pure through the word. And he presented her to himself as a flawless church, holy and blameless. And in the same way is how husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. They feed and care for their body just as Christ does the church. And I was throwing this at my husband to say, can you love me like this? Oh, I threw a big one. That's a huge thing. But could you imagine? And I hope you imagine this when we were going through this passage a few weeks ago. But can you imagine with me if all marriages were like this? Where husbands love their wives to this degree with this intensity, that they would give their lives for their wife, that they would love their wife as they love their own self. Right? Divorce rates would plummet. Therapists, not just marriage counselors, but all therapists would be out of jobs. The term and idea of broken homes would disappear. This kind of love is an overwhelming and perfect love, right? This is a love that doesn't see the flaws or the faults, but instead, this is a love that calls the bride beautiful. This is a love that says, I will die to make you holy and blameless. This is a love that equates the person that I'm with, my spouse, my wife, to myself, right? This is the way that Jesus loves the church. Right, church, can you see that? That this is how much Christ loves the church. And so how does the church respond to his love? And this is where we would go back to the wives' passage. And this is where I would say the church submits to Christ. As wives submit to their husband, the church should submit to Christ. And it's in this submission and the love that Christ has for the church, and that's what leads us, that's what motivates us, drives us to love the church. We love because he first loved us. We love the church because Christ loves the church. Can you say that with me? We love the church because Christ loves the church. And if last week's message that we are the one body of Christ didn't already convince you that we need to love the church, then I raise you one more and I say that we love the church because Christ loves the church. And it's this reason that being Christian is pretty much synonymous with loving the church. I've had students in Power Wave ask me, Pastor Emma, can we be Christian and not go to church? Can we be Christian and not love the church? You know, and I'm not talking about like, oh, people who will say like, oh, I want to love the church and I'm still learning, or I'm surrendering, I'm getting there, I know that I should be there, or I've I've been hurt and I'm healing. That's not who I'm talking about. But this is for those who proudly say, I don't believe in the church. I don't need the church, or the church is not for me. I just don't love the church. It's for these people that I would say, can you even be Christian if you don't love the church? Because the definition of being Christian is Christ-like, right? Is the mini Christ, to be like Christ. And if Christ loves the church to this degree, if he loves the church that he gave himself, he gave his life for her, then logically, mathematically, scientifically, it tracks that being Christian is to love the church to that depth, to get to that degree. And something that Pastor Fabi has said before, and I echo it, is that Jesus didn't die for just you. Jesus died for the church, and you are part of the church. So let me conclude with this, with a reminder that we are the bride of Christ, called beautiful, loved deeply, and perfectly. And I want to ask you today, in your heart of hearts, church, do you guys recognize this truth? Can you understand this? Do you know that you are beautiful and deeply loved? And that because you, and that's because you are a part of the church who has been made one. We have been made one to be called the bride of Christ. You know, and if any of us are struggling, if any of us are having that struggle to love the church, and still trying to figure out how to love the church, or why I even need to love the church, you might even need to start there in that very core to understand that you are part of the church and that you are beautifully and deeply loved. We love the church because Christ loves the church and you are part of the church. Can you guys turn to the person next to you and say, you and I are part of the church. Oh, let me edit that, sorry. Turn to someone else because you already did that. So turn to someone else and say, you and I are the church. Right? Those around you, all of us here, we are the church. And so as I just conclude today, I hope and pray that you will recognize that each one of you here are the church, that we make up the church, and that you will be able to love the church deeply and see its beauty as Christ does. Let's pray. Lord Father God, we thank you so much that you would remind us and that you would call us to be your bride, that you love us, God, as a groom loves his bride. And so, Lord, as we continue in this journey, as we continue in this chapter, this season of trying to figure out what it looks like to love the church, not shallowly, but God, from the core, the very core of who we are, Father, won't you continue to speak to us and fill us with understanding of what you have called the church and how you have died for the church. And so, Lord, may we love the church not out of a sense of duty or responsibility because we have to love the church, but God, may we love the church as a response to the love that you have already shown, to the work that you have already done for us, God. God, we just thank you that we don't... In spite of our imperfection and our flaws, you call us to come. And when we come, you call us beautiful. That you died to make us holy and blameless to you. So God, may we remember this. And may it drive us and may it motivate us to love you more. And consequently, to love the church deeper. We thank you, God. We give you all the glory and praise. And we pray all these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Let's take this time to respond to our God. Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battle ground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory is your power in us. scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. And never once did we ever walk alone. And never once did you leave us on our own. And you are faithful, God. And you are faithful. Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory is your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. And never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, and you are faithful. Scars and struggles. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, never once, no, we ever walk alone. But with joy our hearts can say, never once, no, we ever walk alone. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. And you are faithful, God. You are faithful. You are faithful, God. You are faithful. You are faithful, God. You are faithful. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Sing the chorus, never once. And never once did we ever walk alone. And never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God. You are faithful.
Yes, Lord, remind us of the simple truth that our identity is not shaped and formed just by the way we live, but by what you call us and who you call us to be. And who you call us to be with. And that is your bride, the church, the community that we're in together. So Lord, we just pray, can we be a church that honors you? Can we be a church that loves you? Can we be a church that loves the people you love? Can we be a church that breaks, well, what breaks your heart? Lord, and teach us how to be this. Because the truth is, we are fools and we cannot. So teach us to walk in your ways. Lord, thank you so much. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's give glory to God, church.